I'm going to take you about what I call the next evolution of environmental protection in California. You're right, we have the greenest governor in the country, if not the nation. I was brought aboard 4 years ago. Previous job, I was an environmental safety manager at a steel mill in California. A lot of people, wow, is there a steel mill in California? Not only was it a steel mill, but we were very, very profitable. Steel, as you know, is the number one recycled material in America. More steel is recycled than paper, plastic, anything else lumped together. The governor wanted the regulative to be the regulator, and he wanted people, I don't know, during my interview, I said, I have low tolerance for bureaucracy. I think the state interferes in business too much. You might not want me, and they said, you're the perfect person we want. You know, who thought? So I'm going to take you through a few things that we're doing different at the California Environmental Protection Agency. I have a saying, I've heard a saying that says, things change when the pain of staying the same is greater than the pain of changing. Now, let's see if I can get this high-tech stuff. I'm going to talk briefly the Green Forestry Initiative. And I promise, usually I walk around, but I don't want to walk in front of everybody. And normally at the end, I dive into the trout and the front row. I'm going to talk about the California Take It Back Partnership. I'm going to take you the journey of Enviral Store. What's in your neighborhood? Talk about DTSC sting operation. Very interesting cutting edge in enforcement. And other emerging issues. Things that we're doing different. California Green Chemistry Initiative. You know, this DTSC, we're usually set up at the end of the day, after something's been manufactured and waste comes out the pipe, we regulate it. We regulate it to death. Matter of fact, not only do we regulate it, we regulate the company puts out the stuff. And we can regulate the material out of existence, and a lot of times we can regulate that company out of existence. But we started moving up the pipe in the 80s and 90s to pollution prevention. So it doesn't become a waste. You start doing practices, procedures, using different things. Well, now we get to green chemistry. When I first came on board to DTSC, there was some biomonitoring of nursing mothers in the Bay Area. And they found out these nursing mothers had PBDE in their breast milk. And as you know, PBDE was banned years ago as a fire suppressant. So how is it getting into the breast milk of mothers passing on to children? Well, you know where it was coming from? It wasn't coming from the fire extinguisher system. It was coming from the carpet, the drapes, the chairs, the tablecloth, and everything that appears in our house. Now, it's interesting. We're a Department of Toxic Substances Control, but we could not regulate anything until it became a waste. But we're slowly but surely moving up the pipe. You're seeing me. Okay. What is green chemistry? That's not too bad. Consideration of public health and environmental effects of chemicals during the design of products and processes. In other words, you won't have a toxic waste if you don't use toxic materials. But the manufacturing people have to talk with the regulatory people, have to talk with the environmental people, have this dialogue. You know, we have a lot of people make these great polymers. The polymer makers are making the great polymer, but nobody ever taught them a class in risk assessment, and they never found out what happened to their product in the afterlife. There's a lot of great innovations that come out, but my department, I have my staff here, at the end of the day, we have to deal with it. We have to do something with it. We hate to be the naysayers, so we're glad we're invited to the table. And a lot of times, either you're at the table or you're on the menu, but you're there. Also, it creates a fundamentally new approach to environmental protection. What are the four challenges of green chemistry? Moving towards a cradle-to-cradle framework. We often listen to cradle-to-grain. Something that works fine, and at the end of the day, who cares? We got milk cartons that last longer than the milk. We got newspaper that lasts longer than the news. Now, I come from a generation, I know a lot of you don't remember, but you could scratch the milk carton and get wax under your nails. That meant that was going to be biodegradable. But somebody thought, okay, keep seeing me up there. Here we go. Next one, stimulating the green chemistry challenge. That's the challenge of using less toxic materials to make things. Identifying toxins and products by design, and identifying toxins and products by accident. Okay, the green chemistry, we've got some news that's going to come out pretty soon. We got all the best ideas. We spent 2007 getting the best ideas. We got the PhDs. We got manufacturers. We got everybody together at the table in a dialogue. The governor signed it into life. The CalEPA secretary made the Department of Toxic Substances Control the lead on this. So under the direction of Maureen Gorson, green chemistry, we hope, becomes the global warming version of the chemical thing. It's cutting edge. It makes a lot of sense. It's a big change. It's a revolution. And you'll see more. And I want to encourage people just to come to our website. So I'm just going to give little teasers. Now, more locally, California Take It Back Partnership. Can anybody tell me what that brown box is in the middle? Eight-track tape player. That's how we do succession management at the state. You know what that is? You're going to retire in the next 5 or 10 years. What that is, these are the things we use every day, but what happens in the afterlife? What happens with the eight-track tape player? Fluorescent lights, thermometers, computers, batteries, cell phones. What happens in the afterlife? I just want to go over one example. I only have a couple of minutes. But I'm going to be here for 3 days because I want to hear the best idea. I want to do something different from that we don't normally do in government. I'm actually going to listen, hang around, and write your ideas down. Everybody know what that is? Fluorescent light. It's great. It cuts down on energy. It lasts 3 to 5 years. You know, the cost, by the time you look at the cost and everything, it's a great idea. Fluorescent lights. But at the end of the day, what happens when the light goes out? Do you know what's in fluorescent lights?
Mercury.
And mercury is a neurotoxin, right? And so everybody got together, and it's funny, the message for energy efficiency and environmental protection came out at the same time. But guess who had the resources? The energy efficiency. We're going to cut down on the mercury emissions from power plants because we're going to use less power if everybody uses fluorescent lights. Well, we took the mercury from the power plants and put everybody's living room, kitchen, bathroom, and bedroom. However, all is not lost. We have to combine the message. We have to take energy efficiency. We have to take an environmental protection. And we have to call it a bright idea. You know, this is an example of cutting-edge technology, but at the end of the day, what happens to it? I'm challenging those of you with the ideas and the funding for the ideas. Yes, you're going to make a better mousetrap, but what happens to the mousetrap at the end of the day? Of course, everybody wants a better mousetrap, except the mouse, right? So at the end of the day, what happens to this? So fluorescent lights is a good example of how we need to work together. But the horse has left the barn, but we're slowly but surely chasing it. 2 years ago, fluorescent lights were banned. You cannot put fluorescent lights in the trash, residential trash. Everybody nodded your head saying you knew that, right? But where could you take it? Well, if you have time to drive 5, 10, 15, 20 miles to a household hazardous waste facility, you can do that, but who has time? This is the current model. The chemistry industry puts it together, the components to the manufacturers who puts it on planes, trains, and automobiles and takes it to the wholesalers. The wholesalers take it to, put it on planes, trains, and automobiles and take it to the retailers. The utilities say, flex your power, use fluorescent lights. So the consumer buys fluorescent lights, and at the end of the day, state and local government has to deal with it. So this is the pushback. We're mad as hell, we're not going to take it anymore. Yes, state and local government. We're going to educate the consumer, who's going to educate the utilities, who's going to educate the retailers, who's going to educate the people of the postal service, people that carry it. We're going to talk to the wholesalers. We're going to talk to the transporters. We're going to talk with the manufacturers. We're going to tell the chemistry people, you got to come up with something less toxic. This is the goal. Share responsibility, some fiscal, some others, but everybody should look at it. When something is made, you know, I really believe that if somebody should get a pack unless they can do the life cycle analysis of it and say, this is what's going to happen. Look at these solar panels. At the end of the day, my staff has to grind up those solar panels and find out if there's any heavy metals or anything that leach out of these solar panels. So we're going to get all these solar panels out there, but who's thinking about what happens at the end of the day? I'm like the Lorax. I speak for the tree. Okay, how can we get 37 million Californians? How do we get everybody involved? And how do we get everybody involved in helping us protect the environment? We're not the trash police. We don't have the staff of 37 million people. So how do you get Californians to participate in environmental protection? Well, first, it has to be free. It has to be local. It has to be convenient. It has to be free. Because Californians, we were walk across the store to 7-Eleven and pay $4 for a gallon of milk if we want it that early in the morning rather than wait for Safeway to open up, because it has to be convenient. And we have to have it, you know, we have to have locations where people live, work, shop, play, and worship, because these are things Californians do. I don't know about you, but I don't have a lot of time on the weekends to drive 5, 10, 15, 20 miles to a household hazardous waste facility that may or may not be open. This is what we have to do, but we have to get everybody involved. These are our Take It Back partners. We started the Take It Back partnership. We've got people, we've got retail stores, we've got utilities, we've got manufacturers, we've got everybody involved in the who touches a fluorescent light in the Take It Back partnership. And the goal is to provide free, local, convenient locations for Californians to take back their fluorescent use end of life fluorescent lights. Sesame Street thought it was a bright idea, so they let us use Oscar the Grouch. Oscar the Grouch is now the spokesman for the California Take It Back Partnership. And, as you know, Oscar can tell you what's in the trash and what's not in the trash. So he's going to join forces with the California Environmental Protection Agency to help us get the word out. We don't want these things in the trash. Fluorescent lights are a bright idea, but we don't want them in the trash. This is our Not in My Trash Cam, Not in My Trash campaign with Oscar the Grouch. Again, using Oscar to get the message out, to tell people they can't where they can't take it. Also, I chair what's called the AB 1109 Task Force. We have manufacturers, retail stores, we have environmental groups, we have utilities that are all a part of an idea. How can we do? What are we going to do with these fluorescent lights once they come to end of life? It's something the dialogue should happen a long time ago. So those of you on the cutting edge, think about DTSC. At the end of the day, we're trying to protect the environment. Think about the impact. Don't think cradle to grave. Think cradle to cradle. So, but we have this. We're going to come up with a solution, and we hope this is going to last long enough where we can encourage fluorescent lights. We're not against energy efficiency. I have compact fluorescent lights in my house. I have fluorescent tubes in my house. And yes, you know what I do? I have a choice of taking it to a big box store that does not want to take them, or to a little store like Ace Hardware. Well, I'm going to take mine to Ace Hardware. That's a part of the partnership that will take back the compact fluorescent lights and take them back for free. And also, these are businesses in San Diego. As part of what they're doing for their employees, they're taking back compact fluorescent lights from their employees. Businesses, you have to deal with these things anyway, right? So, they're taking back compact fluorescent lights from their employees. They're not going to take back the tubes because they're a little bit to handle, and we don't want people doing that Star Wars thing with the fluorescent tubes. But they're going to take back fluorescent lights from their employees. They're going to encourage the message. So now people have to work. This is what we do. We go to work every day, 5, 6, 7 days a week. So we have employers that are doing it. This is the ad that didn't work. This is our professor with a compact fluorescent light. But if you recycle with us, we'll leave the light on for you. I'm going to cut down my presentation because I think this is probably one of the best parts of it. I got 2 minutes. Let me run you through some other stuff. What's in your community? This is how you can tell if there's a toxic waste site in the community. We have a program called Environmental Store. You put in the city, you put in the zip code, Monterey. Let's see what we have in Monterey. Oh, we have a site, a couple of sites there. Let's see what's going on at PG&E. Ah, PG&E, they have a station over there, they have a site. You can look up that. You can actually see the report. You can see who's doing the report. And you can go to the website. That's how you can tell what's in your community. So those of you involved in brownfields, those of you involved in remediation, We have the tools, but the state, we're not a very good communicator. So we're asking you to help us communicate. We do have the tools. We have the passion. We want to get it done. So we're asking you, and the leadership. And, you know, we have leadership, we have stewardship, we have a fellowship. But regardless of the ship, we're in the same boat today environmentally. Thank you.